Okay, good afternoon everybody. So I have 15 minutes and it is quite challenging to compress such a topic into 15 minutes, but I will try my best. Of course, I am giving this talk in the presence of some heavyweights from string theory. And so I certainly expect that you will have lots of questions and doubts, and I want to just state at the very beginning that when I say connecting LQD and string theory, I'm not, my premise is not that, you know, string theory is not needed. Certainly it is needed. My basic premise is that that you need insights from loop quantum gravity also, and that they need to be brought together in order to form a complete theory of quantum gravity. So I'm from the National Institute of Technology, Karnataka, in Suratkal, and thanks to the organizers for giving me this opportunity. So I will motivation some hints from ADS-CFP why LQD and string theory should be connected. Then I'll talk about quantization of geometric operators in LQD, and finally show that the number moto action is present in LQD. So the possibilities are, well, why should we worry about LQD and string theory, right? I mean, one can say that string theory is correct and LQD is completely wrong, but that would not be the correct position to take, because LQD is also a physical theory. You start from the quantization of the ABM Hamiltonian and elastical variables, and you are following the laws of the process of physics. So it is as much a theory of physics as string theory is. So now one might say that, well, both of these are wrong and that quantum gravity doesn't really exist. But well, you better hope not, because that would be bad for many of us. Possibility is that string theory is wrong, but now again, string theory is definitely valid, even if at the very least it is as a physical model of a 1D extended object, right? And such objects will exist in nature. So the other possibility is LQG is wrong, but again, it is grounded in universally accepted physics. Both have valid insights. So this is the possibility, I think, which is the only reasonable conclusion. Now, there are hints from ADS, very strong hints from ADS-CFT, which suggest that LQG and string theory should ultimately be connected and should be facets of the same framework. So, we have the notion of holography, first proposed by Tawulf and Suskin, according to which the boundary theory of an ABS anti-dissipative space encodes the bulk physics. So this was formalized in terms of the ABS-CFP correspondence, and there was, you know, lots of work until very recently. These people in Caltech and other places, they realized in trying to reconstruct the bulk physics from the boundary operators of the conformal field theory that there was a correspondence between the methods of quantum error correction and this bulk boundary correspondence. And then Yulan Shi showed that there is an exact holographic mapping. So what is this? This shows that there are these objects called tensor networks. So tensor networks are basically abstract graphs whose vertices are labeled by tensors and whose edges are labeled by some other possibly tensors. And what he showed is that one has an exact holographic mapping from certain tensor networks to the ABS geometry. Now, Munshin Han showed that this exists in LQD also, and the thing is that tensor networks are nothing more than spin networks. The spin networks are the basic kinematical entities and the kinematical states in LQD. So it can hardly be a coincidence that ABS-CFP, which comes out of string theory, ultimately ends up being described in terms of quantum error correction and objects which are the fundamental ingredients of LQD. So what is LQD? Well, in LQG, background independence is non-negotiable. We start with the Einstein equations and do not fix any kind of a frame. The whole process of quantization takes the diffeomorphism invariance of Einstein equations
very seriously. And gravity is such as a gauge theory, much like Young's electromagnetism. And then we perform canonical quantization, starting with the Arnold semester 3 plus 1 splitting of the Hamiltonian. And what is found is that these states called spin networks are exact solutions of the resulting constraints. So when you do the ABM splitting, you get constraints, the diffeomorphism, Gauss, Hamiltonian constraints, and spin networks are solutions of both these. And on these spin networks, one can define operators whose expectation values correspond to geometric observables such as areas and volumes. So this is literally a theory of quantum geometry. And what this predicts is that there is a limit to the smallest possible measurable area and the limit to the smallest possible measurable volume. In other words, there are atoms of space, and space-time is granular and is built up by putting these atoms together. And this can be applied, for instance, to cosmology, and we get to quantum cosmology, which, for instance, resolves the Big Bang singularity. And it can also be applied to counting the degeneracy of states of the horizon of a black hole, and it gives you the Bekenstein-Hawking ratio. Though, of course, the same thing has been done many times in string theory also, and Ashok Sen has, I think, mentioned in the paper that there is some, he feels that there is a disagreement, but again, those are more technical issues. But overall, the basic physical picture is there.
I mean, you have to, I mean, there's no agreement on the choice of the easy parameter, right? To match.
The issue. Right. Okay, yeah, I mean, easy parameter, there are issues. There are definitely issues. I will mention the easy parameter again. Well, string theory is basically quantum field theory of extended objects rather than point-like particles. It originated in an attempt to explain the so-called rigid trajectories, which is found in hadronic collisions. And it turned out that, well, this rigid, this model led to something called the dual resonance model, and then the dual resonance model turned out to be something that originated from the theory of a string. And then when Tahoof came along with the QCD, that basically sidelined the entire dual resonance project. But then people realized, Shirk and Schwartz and others realized, that the spectrum of the string contains gauge fields, and also it contains a spin to graviton. So that gave birth to string theory as a theory of possibly everything. Gravity, electromagnetism, and so on. Small gravity. Yes. No, I meant to say. Of course, sir. Right. Well, Tahoof's discovery of asymptotic freedom. Well, actually, sir, Tahoof
will do it also, apparently, but he did not.
Tahoof didn't publish it. Did not publish it, and if you don't publish it. So these are the basic physical modes of the string. And then, of course, the most physical output of string theory is the idiocy of correspondence. So now, let us look at the common features of both of these. Well, both of these have their degrees of freedoms are essentially one-dimensional objects. And of course, I know string theory also has high-dimensional objects called planes, but such an analog also exists in RG. But it all begins with strings, and that is also present in RG in the form of edges of spin networks. Then black hole entropy, you get the Bekenstein-Hawking formula from BPS state counting in string theory, and from this counting of partitions of the black hole horizon area. Then both of these predict that there is a sort of a quantized geometry at the smallest scale. In LQG, the prediction is a little bit indirect, but it is still there. It says that there is a minimum size that a string can take, and this can be understood, I guess, in the simplest sense as a consequence of the uncertainty principle. That if you take a string and shrink it down below a certain area, then you will the uncertainty principle will not allow you to do that. In LQG, this is an essential part of the theory itself. Finally, matter, which is a problem in both of these models,
But it does exist. In this case, it exists in the form of one proposal that I know of, though I'm sure there are others, as stacked DAE-BRNS, which give you new and gauge fields, and in LQG, it exists in the form of topological degrees of freedom. And if you again look at these two, it turns out that these two look very, very similar, these pictures. But again, that's for another time. The state space consists of strings and perhaps more generally string networks. And in fact, one of the most interesting things I found was in a paper by Ashok Sen, in which he first introduced string networks. One of the last quotes, sentences he says is that string networks look very much like the spin networks of loop quantum gravity. And so this was back in 1998. And he said that so it would be quite possible, it is possible that these two, you know, are the same. Of course, over the past 20 years, you know, Poisson's views are definitely allowed to evolve, but I still hold that in favor of this correspondence.
But one question.
Yes.
Spin networks are not the only solution to all the constraints,
Well,
have solutions.
What are the constraints, sir?
I don't know. I mean,
no. Spin networks form the.
I don't know.
Spin networks are the solution.
Are the only solutions?
Yeah.
There are no other solutions.
There are other representations. There is something called the Hamiltonian flux representation, but again, it is, you know, a different representation with a momentum representation of position of the system. Apart from spin networks, you can also work with so-called loop states. That is again another representation. So spin networks is a way of representing the states of characterizing the Hilbert space, which is the most convenient and natural way. So, LQG again is a very rapid outline. For those of you who don't know ABM or gauge theory, it will be, I regret to say, too fast. But of course, here I can advertise a small monograph that I have written with my collaborator Sanan Wilson Thompson. It's available for free on the archive and for purchase from Springer if you have the funds for it. And its purpose is to introduce loop quantum gravity to those who are interested but who are afraid of all the mathematics. Such as me, I'm also afraid of the mathematics. That's why I went into LQG, no string theory. So, LQG, the phase space consists of triads, which are basically vectors which form a basis of space, and an SU2 valued connection. These two objects satisfy Poisson brackets, which is the same Poisson bracket as that for the electric and magnetic fields in Mills theory. Out of this, we can construct gauge invariant variables, which are holonomies, basically integrating the connection along the loop. And holonomies are nothing but group elements. They tell you how a vector is parallel transported from one point to another. And the parallel transport measures the geometry of the space-time in which the vector is being transported. And the other variable are these smear triads. So basically you take these two, a pair of these vectors, and you smear them over surface. And this actually corresponds to two-dimensional surfaces or areas. And states are, in FPG, are functions of these holonomies. So for instance, this is like the position representation, right? Now, this these functions of holonomies, this is not very clear to people or some many times, so I have tried to make it a little clearer. You consider the state space of an n-body quantum mechanical system. In the position representation, you have psi as a function of the n-coordinates of the particle. But you can also equally well write it in terms of momentum representation using the Fourier transform. Similarly, this state space, which is a function of the holonomy, so you have an abstract graph, something like this. The edges of the graph are labeled by elements of SU2. They correspond to the parallel transport of a vector from this point to this point. So the wave function is a function of all of these holonomies taken together. Then, using the fact that one can take any function on SU2 and decompose it into something which is a function of the representation of residue using a Peter-Weyl theorem. This is basically Fourier transform of functions on a group rather than Fourier transform of functions on RJ. These states can be written as in terms of spin networks, where edges are labeled by representations of SU2 or spins. That's where the term spin networks comes from. Now, in LTG, one of the most basic objects is the area operator. And the area of a surface is nothing but the integral of the metric of the surface. And this metric can be written in terms of this, this triad field. And now, using the fact that this triad is canonically conjugate to the connection from the Poisson brackets which I showed you earlier, the operator version can be written as a derivation. And so, this whole thing can be written as a derivation in, of the connection. And this action of this derivation on the spin network states can be worked out, and it's actually quite straightforward. It gives you this Lie algebra basis vector, MATI, and when you put it all together, you find that the action of this area operator on the state is simply the sum of this Casimir operator, J into J plus 1, right? So what is the physical interpretation? The interpretation is that you have a patch of space, and there is an edge which is crossing this patch, and this edge has a label J. Then what this patch, what this does is it endows this surface with an area which is given by root of J times J plus 1. So this is creating geometry, essentially. This area doesn't have any geometry, it is being endowed with geometry due to the presence of this string. Gamma is, I'll come to that in a second. Gamma is the initial parameter, and it's very important in the story. It's missing here, it should be there. So using this, one can put together the areas of large surfaces like black hole horizons, and one can do the statistical state counting, and you get the Bekenstein-Hawking expression. Now, the fact that this area operator exists in LPG is what led me to think that, well, you know, the connection to string theory is quite straightforward. Now, of course, this connection that I'm going to present, it is, mathematically speaking, very, very, very trivial. And so, you know, at first sight, you might be tempted to just think it's completely wrong. But then physically also, but physically it makes a lot of sense, I think. So you have the number go to action, which is nothing but the integral of the area of the world sheet, right? And of course, this is not all of string theory. String theory is much more than the number go to action, right? But I think making a correspondence with the bosonic string is a start, right? And this area can be understood, can be viewed as the expectation value of this area operator acting on a state space where there are many strings. So in this is actually more a connection, would be a connection between string field theory and your quantum gravity rather than string theory, because you have lots of strings. And what the picture is that we have a single string, and as it is moving, its world sheet will intersect other strings. And as it intersects other strings, at every point, wherever there is an intersection, you will get the action of this area operator. And this area operator will give you a little bit of area, physical area, to that world. So this number go to action can be understood in this way, as simply the action of this area operator on a state of strings. And I'm still very much new to this, so you'll forgive if I make any completely wrong statements, but I've recently learned that the string free theory actually can be written in something suggestively similar, where Q is a BRST operator. And I'm trying to see if there is any relationship between Q and A. And finally, in string theory, you have the string tension. In LPG, you have the inversive parameter. And if you just compare the form of these two statements, you can see that there should be a relationship. There should be some sort of a string loop potential parameter in LQG, and this imaging parameter would then be a coefficient of proportionality between the two pixels. And then finally, it's a good time for speculation, I think. My 4.5 month old daughter appears to think so. Thank you. And I apologize if I've taken more than 15 minutes.
Any question or comment? Sorry, again, net won't come.
Yes.
String theory is a theory of quantum gravity.
Yes.
And there is one more theory of quantum gravity, which is loop quantum gravity. And I have always wondered, is there a connection?
Sir, one second.
It's good that.
One second.
It's okay. So, string theory is recognized to be a candidate theory for quantum gravity. In the same way, loop quantum gravity also is considered as a candidate. I have always wondered whether there is a connection. It's good that he has at least speculated how the connection might work out. So I am very glad that he is proceeding on that direction.
I am humbled by this, by these words of support from Professor.
I just have one comment. And at least trying to get the string field theory action, which is not the number body actually. But I believe that you should not go the number body route, because string field theory action at least has some answer. This is that body.
Exactly.
So maybe that feature.
Yes, yes. No, and just like Professor Govindraj is just saying that the point of the goal of string field theory is to come up with a background independent version of string theory. So the string theory action is background independent. String field theory action is background independent. So, but again, I'm a student, very early stages of string theory, and I'm learning what I can at some possible rate, given by teaching constraints and such.
Thank you.